Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Habsburg Empire, A New History, by Pieter M. Judson. Narrated by Michael Page. Introduction. On Tuesday the 13th and Monday the 19th of June, 1911, in villages, towns and cities across Imperial Austria, over 4.5 million voters turned out to elect a new parliament. Campaigns in individual constituencies were hard-fought, and party agitators did their best up until the very last minute to rally their voters. From Vorarlberg to Bukovina, Prague to Dubrovnik, party rallies, bombastic programs, endless pamphlets, even clever satires, dominated public space in the weeks leading up to the election. Party newspapers urged readers who had not already done so to hurry to the local government office with official identification documents. Here they could pick up their voter identification cards, legitimation in German, which they should keep handy after they voted in case their district held a runoff election. All warned against last-minute chicanery devised by their opponents. Christian social newspapers in Graz and Linz implored campaign workers to continue campaigning in every street and neighborhood of every district until voting ended. In Chernowitz, Czernowitz, Chernivtsi, the bourgeois German, Romanian, Ukrainian and Polish nationalist parties rallied their communities to unseat a socialist incumbent. In Petau, Ptuj, the Slovene language Stajerts exhorted its readers as voters, farmers, workers and craftsmen, urging them to unity behind its favored candidates in South Styria. Prognosticators and candidates like to exaggerate the political stakes in any election. In retrospect, the stakes of this election in 1911 may not have been exceptional, but the level of excitement expressed in regional newspapers as well as the high turnout rate on election day appear to reflect a high level of significance attributed by individual voters to the act of voting. One social democratic newspaper captured the essence of this significance, proclaiming, "When you cast your ballot in the urn, you decide your own future." As Austrians swarmed to their polling places to decide their own futures, they were well aware that they were also determining the future of their empire. Some of them even paid the ultimate price for their determination to vote, as shocked newspaper readers across the monarchy learned on 20 June, the day after the end of the voting. An election day massacre had taken place the day before in the Galician oil town of Drohobych. A crowd of Jewish and Ruthenian or Ukrainian-speaking Galicians gathered in the town square determined to exercise their right to vote at the end of a bitterly contested parliamentary campaign. Many worried with good reason that the local authorities would try to fix the outcome in favor of incumbent Nathan Löwenstein and prevent them from voting for their candidate, Zionist Gershon Zipper. The former was the candidate of the town's Jewish power brokers and of the conservative elites of the Polish club, who effectively ruled the crownland of Galicia. For this election, the town bosses set up a single polling station to accommodate close to 8,000 potential voters. During the day, the local police prevented anyone but known Löwenstein supporters from entering to vote. Several times, mounted police drove restless crowds away from the voting station. Instead of doing their expected brisk sales from the presence of a festive crowd of voters, local shop owners experienced broken windows and collateral damage from the increasingly frustrated mob. Then, in the afternoon, the town bosses encouraged troops brought in from the Zhezhov garrison near the fortress at Przemyśl to fire on the crowd. 26 people died immediately, including women, the elderly, and children. Investigators later determined that most of the dead had been shot in the back, suggesting that they had been fleeing the troops. This dramatically disturbing story does not simply illustrate the lengths that local political authorities were willing to go to maintain their power in an age of mass voter mobilization. It can also be read as a sign of the sheer intensity with which people in an industrial town far from Vienna and Budapest engaged politically and emotionally with their empire. This was only the second election held since the adoption of universal manhood suffrage for Parliament in 1907, and only the third since the enfranchisement of men without property in 1897. Precisely for these reasons, people treated the hard-fought right to vote as critical to their lives. Elections in the crownland of Galicia generally had a reputation for corruption at the time. The inhabitants of Drohobych knew well that the men who ran their town would devise every possible form of chicanery to control the outcome of the poll. Nevertheless, an ethnically, religiously, and linguistically diverse crowd of working-class people was determined to elect its agreed-upon candidate. Zionists and Ruthene peasants may seem like unlikely allies, especially since we are used to hearing about conflict in imperial Austria that pitted national or religious groups against each other. Both groups, however, cared deeply about this election to the parliament in faraway Vienna, even though this institution had much less influence over their daily lives than did the Galician government in Lemberg, Lvov, Lviv, and the local bosses who represented that regime. Why were the stakes so high, in both symbolic and real terms, for everyone in Drohobych that day? What does this tell us about the place of the Habsburg Empire and its institutions in people's lives? For many Austrians, the empire constituted an alternative source of symbolic and real power that might not outweigh the power of local elites, but could at least temper it. When Zionist and Ruthene political leaders complained to the Ministry of Interior in Vienna about local corrupt electoral practices, for example, they did receive some legal redress, even if Vienna could not fully rectify the fundamental unfairness of local political conditions. On 19 June, the crowd in Drohobych used its imperial right to vote as a point of leverage, however small, against the people it perceived to be its local oppressors. Parliamentary elections held immense cultural and social significance to people across the empire. Resident men over the age of 23 may have been the only ones officially entitled to vote in these elections, but the presence of women and children among the casualties at Drohobych testifies to the degree to which empire concerned everyone on that day, not simply the enfranchised and not simply the powerful. Franchise restrictions did little to prevent women, youths, and even children from participating in this political, cultural, civic, and often celebratory ritual that brought thousands of people together, connecting their community to the rest of the empire. An examination of the boisterous events of June 1911 in villages and towns across Imperial Austria would reveal similar socially, religiously, and often linguistically diverse groups of people asserting their voices, often in unexpected alliances, to construct the future of their empire. The same was often true in the Hungarian half of the dual monarchy, despite the narrow franchise that limited the electorate there. Nevertheless, by the 1890s, crowds of the unenfranchised in Hungary often mobilized to support a particular position or candidate on election day, even though they could not vote. On election day, the empire functioned for all of them as a screen on which to project their beliefs, values, hopes, frustrations, and above all, their visions for the future. Election day constituted a critical ritual of empire in which people of all social classes shared. People held common expectations of the election process as well, expectations that officials would guarantee their fairness and legality, expectations that the authorities in Drohobych so egregiously and tragically violated. This book is about how countless local societies across Central Europe engaged with the Habsburg dynasty's efforts to build a unified and unifying imperial state from the 18th century until the First World War. It investigates how imperial institutions, administrative practices, and cultural programs helped to shape local society in every region of the empire, from the late 18th century until the first decades of the 20th century. It also examines how citizens in every corner of the empire engaged with these various practices and institutions, often appropriating them for their own purposes or reinterpreting them to fit their interests. Taken as a whole, these complex processes of empire building gave citizens in every corner of the empire collective experiences that crossed linguistic, confessional, and regional divides. The violence at Drohobych in 1911 is only one of countless examples that demonstrate how an approach to imperial history from the point of view of shared institutions, practices, and cultures challenges and rewrites the nation-based narratives to which students of the Habsburg Empire are accustomed. Placing empire at the center of the investigation, rather than seeing linguistic groups or ethnically defined nations as the building blocks of history, foregrounds a different kind of narrative for Central and Eastern Europe's history. Regional, linguistic, religious, or ethnic, what contemporaries around 1900 often called national, differences in society did not determine politics in Habsburg Central Europe in easily predictable ways. The crowd in Drohobych, at which the soldiers took aim, for example, was in fact multi-confessional and multilingual in character. As they asserted their right to vote, on that day at least, people did not interpret their political differences primarily in conventional ethnic or national, Jews versus Ruthenes versus Poles, terms. The struggle on June 19 was a populist one that pitted the people against local bosses who were unfairly trying to rob them of their rights as imperial citizens. Other situations saw other kinds of alliances. To be sure, rulers, statesmen, bureaucrats, military advisers, or scientific experts helped ensure the rise and success of an imperial Habsburg state. But it was also an ongoing project that engaged the minds, hearts, and energies of many of its citizens at every level of society. This book focuses on the relationship between the state and society by analyzing the mutual construction of a Habsburg Empire from several directions: state building from above and state building from below. Here I understand the state as far more than a discreetly defined realm of politics or a set of formal institutions separated from society. Instead, the state I discuss refers to a broad range of diverse cultural, religious, and social practices, while society constitutes an equally important site where politics functions. In the 18th century, Habsburg rulers sought to apply a unified and centralized set of institutions to the collection of diverse territories over which they ruled, many of which functioned largely according to their own particular laws, institutions, and administrative traditions. Centralization and unification of the new empire were critical to project great power status and effectively withstand the military attacks of its many enemies. At the same time, however, this Habsburg state, like other developing states in Europe, had to be capable of inspiring an emotional attachment among its peoples by encouraging them to link their individual or group interests to imperial interests. The book opens by describing and analyzing a broad range of administrative and institutional experiments inaugurated by 18th century monarchs Maria Theresa and her sons Joseph II and Leopold II, from diminishing the forced labor burdens on the peasantry to taxing the nobility. These measures elicited strong support for empire from peasants in several regions of the empire. Later chapters turn to subsequent state-building maneuvers carried out by their imperial successors. Liberal absolutism in the 1850s, constitutional experiments in 1848 and the 1860s, the dualist settlement of 1867, experiments with other so-called national settlements after 1900, universal manhood suffrage in the Austrian half of the monarchy in 1907, federalization in October 1918, and the adoption by successor states of some Habsburg laws and practices in 1919 and 1920. Each of these landmarks in Habsburg history is well known, and with only one real exception, the book follows a fairly conventional periodization. What is different here is how I explain those landmark moments, where I locate causal factors, and above all, how they engage, and are even often produced by, initiatives and support from society. In each of these familiar historical periods, the Habsburgs continued their efforts to forge a unified empire with a unified purpose. They did so, however, in ways that demonstrated remarkable creativity and flexibility in practice, while rhetorically maintaining that the power of their empire remained unchanged and unbroken. Imperial state building took place under and necessarily responded to radically changing local empire and European-wide conditions, which demanded nimble strategies dependent upon the support of different allies in society. By themselves, the imperial regime's visions, policies, tactical retreats, or strategic compromises reveal little to us about the meanings of empire in local society. From the first, however, Habsburg state-building policies sought implicit and sometimes explicit support from a very broad array of groups and social actors. In the 18th century, for example, the peasantry and the educated middle classes, for very different reasons, saw themselves as the indirect beneficiaries of Habsburg reform. They often responded actively and opportunistically to the spaces imperial policy created in public life, as with the end of feudal agrarian institutions or the creation of an imperial bureaucracy, to pursue their interests vigorously. In doing so, they signaled their qualified support for empire and its institutions. Thanks to creative developments in law, economy, and education before the outbreak of the French Revolution in 1789, the Habsburg regime developed a model of common imperial citizenship that implicitly promised legal equality and equal obligations to its subjects, soon to be citizens. This concept of a universal citizenship was to some extent the inadvertent consequence of Habsburg efforts to create a more productive class of independent taxpayers out of the enserfed peasants under the rule of the local nobility. A free, tax-paying peasantry would constitute a far greater resource to a cash-strapped state with great power ambitions. Freeing the peasantry, however, also meant diminishing the local powers of the nobility, and leaving many nobles without the necessary resources to work their lands. Both peasants and noble landowners understood the stakes of the Habsburg efforts at reform. In the early 19th century, the Habsburgs extended the promise of legal civic equality to men and women of all social classes in the various law codes it proclaimed, culminating with the Civil Code of 1811 that applied to much of the empire. Of course, legal equality did not imply social equality or cultural equality. Status based on refined hierarchies of education and class remained ubiquitous in public life and was reflected in the complex grades of civil service employment increasingly open to members of the educated middle classes and made visible by the uniforms those civil servants wore. The 18th century Habsburgs also developed social policies that reinforced a sense of equal citizenship by promoting patriotic feelings for the state and respect for the social order. Universal primary education in vernacular languages, the creation of an imperial bureaucracy drawn largely from the educated middle classes, the establishment of an independent judiciary, and the promotion of free trade within the empire would also break the power of the regional aristocracy and promote Austria's great power status. Moreover, these policies gave their beneficiaries in Austrian society a more palpable stake in the empire. At the end of the Napoleonic Wars, from Trieste, Trst, in the west, to Brody in the east, the evidence demonstrates that many social groups already identified strongly with their empire, from landless peasants to merchants engaged in interregional trade, from local priests to district bureaucrats. Imperial patriotism, too, became a growing force in the Austrian Empire, founded in 1804, even as local patriots defined empire in terms of their own regional interests. By the mid-19th century, many people defined their particular economic visions or political programs specifically in terms of the benefits to be had from the common framework of empire, including, of course, many nationalists. Constitutional reforms spurred the mobilization of local society to participate directly in imperial institutions, channeling their dynamic activism into remarkably similar political, civic, and cultural institutions throughout the empire. The implementation of elected municipal councils run by citizens themselves in the mid-19th century, to say nothing of regular elections for regional diets and the imperial parliament, brought more and more people into a public life whose specific character was determined by imperial institutions. The reform of primary, secondary, and university educational systems across the empire in the 1850s and 1860s also reinforced the potential benefits a unified empire could bring to several populations. Among academic and amateur practitioners of the natural and social sciences, the fundamental idea of a regularized and integrated imperial space shaped research questions and methodological approaches in the 19th century. As historians of science have recently demonstrated, attempts to justify the spatial dimensions and demographic diversity of the Habsburg Empire in natural terms influenced the development of several scientific fields, from meteorology to seismology to anthropology. In 1883, under the patronage of Crown Prince Rudolf, the government of Austria-Hungary initiated a vast project to make visible the diversity and dimensions of empire. The goal was to collect studies of the empire's highly diverse geology, flora, fauna, and populations in a set of illustrated volumes to be made available for public subscription, the so-called Kronprinzenwerk. This scientific labor did not merely reflect empire, it actively forged an explicit vision of a particularly Habsburg empire, one that united different cultures as it promoted their autonomous development. What about nations? By the last third of the 19th century, the empire of the Habsburgs increasingly asserted its unique ability to create a productive unity out of the cultural diversity of its peoples. Why did this issue matter? Was the Habsburg monarchy fundamentally more culturally or socially diverse than other contemporary European states? The second half of the 19th century saw the rise of powerful nationalist political movements across Europe. They increasingly explained their nation's distinctiveness in cultural terms, symbolized by their different language use and religious practice, ideas they owed largely to popularized versions of the writings of Johann Gottfried Herder, 1744-1803. By 1900, many nationalists argued that national differences were in fact unbridgeable, and that national communities should have autonomous rights of self-cultivation and political organization in a manner reminiscent of liberal arguments about the natural rights of individuals. In the Habsburg Empire, nationalist arguments often developed in relation to specific institutional spaces, such as the courts or schools created by the empire. Many nationalist political battles in the late 19th century, for example, focused specifically on linguistic usage and language rights in public life. In doing so, they built at first on Habsburg traditional functional practices of publishing decrees or providing primary education in vernacular languages. When Austrian and Hungarian legislatures passed constitutional laws in the 1860s, however, they anchored the traditional expectations about language use in constitutional law. This in turn created many rich sites for developing a politics based on the implementation of promises around equality of language use. This book treats political nationalism in Habsburg Central Europe as a product of imperial structures and regional traditions, not as sui generis expressions of trans-historical ethnic groups, the way that 19th century activists argued. Historians have, of course, long ago rejected such explanations, but they have been less successful in developing explanations that relate the concepts of empire and nationhood in a productive fashion. Concepts of nationhood and ideas of empire depended on each other for their coherence. As intimately intertwined subjects, they developed in dialogue with each other, rather than as binary opposites. By 1900, many ideologists of empire harbored nationalist beliefs, and nationalists regularly sought political solutions within the legal framework of empire. Nationalist movements organized around ideas of cultural difference played a key role in many of the empire's political and social institutions. Still, their prominence in high politics was not necessarily reflected in their centrality to daily life concerns. Nations mattered most to people when it appeared that their fundamental cultural rights were under threat, usually by another nation. But before they could matter, nationalists had to explain these rights, make them relevant to local social life, and warn when they were threatened. Nationalism may have stirred up passions in group situations, as in rituals surrounding the taking of the decennial census or on election days, but its centrality often faded once an event had ended and more quotidian concerns took over. Nationalist movements did not always influence the concerns and rhythms of everyday life in more than a passing manner. Attempts to persuade people to pattern their economic behaviors or educational goals along nationalist lines often failed to gain much popular traction. the mere existence of linguistic, religious, and regional differences among the citizens of empire did not by themselves determine the course of imperial history. Nor did these differences alone create a sense that the world was divided among ethnic nations with equal claims on political power. At the dawn of the 20th century, the insistence that all people belonged to ethnic or national communities must be understood partly as a product of political work accomplished by nationalist activists. It was also, however, a product of the ways agents of the empire categorized its diverse peoples in order to govern them more effectively. Considering the experiences of empire. In the past 30 years, dedicated scholars of Central and Eastern European history have revised, often radically, many of the public's most cherished presumptions about the history of the Habsburg Empire. They no longer see the empire as an anachronism among states in the 19th century, nor do they see nationalist conflict in simple and unchanging terms. Their studies have proposed exciting interpretations of local or regional phenomena, particularly in their focus on vibrant political cultures in the empire. The very multilingual character of empire itself spurred historians of the Habsburg monarchy to adopt creative transnational and interdisciplinary approaches to studying the empire. It has made the empire's historians into innovative leaders in the field of European history. Their work has also begun to make historians of self-styled nation-states think more creatively about cultural differences that may lurk just below the surface of assertions of national homogeneity. At the same time, however, very few authors have used these revisionist works to retool our broad narratives of the empire as a whole. If among scholars of Europe, Habsburg history has become known as a laboratory for creative innovation in historical studies, this news has also been slow to reach non-specialists within and beyond the academy. General studies of Europe and modern history treat the region as an exceptional corner of Europe, often due to the presence of several ethnic and religious groups in its societies, but also because of its problematic economic development, often characterized as backward. As insightful an historian as the late Tony Judt could write in 1996, for example, that certainly, the centers of economic and cultural gravity moved around quite dramatically, but they rarely moved very far east and never beyond Vienna. Whatever the passing brilliance of the civilizations of Prague or Vilna, they were never capitals of something definably European in the way that was at different moments true of Florence, Madrid, Amsterdam, Paris, London, or Vienna. As Peter Booger points out, not only does Prague lie to the east of Vienna on Judt's mental map of Europe, a common geographic error among historians, but he also presumes that the reader will understand implicitly why, in fact, Prague, or for that matter Vilna, should not be considered definably European in their history. European historians may express their sense of the region's difference in the more objective-sounding language of economic development, or attribute it in part to the effects of the Cold War. Moreover, as several scholars have argued lucidly, Central and Eastern Europe's imagined difference from the West has often served to confirm the rest of Europe's comforting normalcy. This trend is particularly clear in the spate of books on the First World War written in the last decade, some to mark the centenary of its outbreak. Almost all continued a tradition of pathologizing the Habsburg Empire as teetering on the verge of collapse thanks to nationalist conflict. We need not gravitate to an opposite extreme by asserting Central and Eastern Europe's blanket similarity to the rest of Europe. Rather, we need to understand the history of this region, its institutions, and its economic, social, political, and cultural development within, not outside of, a broadly comparative European context. This book underscores just how similar the Habsburg Empire was to other European states, while highlighting moments when it pioneered new ideas about nationhood and new practices of governance. Like every European state, however, it also developed distinctive institutions and practices that make its history unique. Above all, this book is an argument about the character, development, and enduring legacies of empire in Central and Eastern Europe. It does not claim to offer an exhaustive history of the Habsburg monarchy. Some listeners may not find significant material on important regions or events in which they have a particular interest. Others may wish for more coverage of foreign policy and great power politics, both admittedly subjects of critical importance to Habsburg history. Such lacunae are inevitable in a book driven by revisionist arguments about why empire and its institutions mattered so much to so many for so long, rather than by an encyclopedic impulse to describe the empire's vast and varied histories. Nevertheless, as the author, I am keenly aware of significant gaps in the text, of left-out events, some critical and some which could perhaps modify the arguments of the book, and of the tendency to simplify when writing a synthetic work. The Habsburg Empire is clearly indebted to superb work by other historians, especially in the ways it builds on their attempts to move the focus of history writing in this region away from questions of nationhood. It is limited, however, by its changing focus on particular regions and developments. Since the collapse of the Habsburg monarchy at the end of the First World War in 1918, narratives of nationhood have dominated its history. Less often have scholars made the empire itself the focus of their interpretations. In an oft-cited attempt to push scholars to take a less nationally and more socially oriented approach to the region, for example, historian István Deargued in 1967 that there were no dominant nationalities in the Austro-Hungarian monarchy. There were dominant classes, institutions, interest groups, and professions. Several influential historians of the region in the 1980s followed this line of argument. In 1980, Gary Cohen and John Boyer published influential studies of politics and society in Prague and Vienna, which abandoned traditional presumptions about the primacy of nationhood in the region. In Cohen's analysis, national belonging was a socially contingent factor, not given at birth or determined by descent. Especially among Prague's working classes in the 19th century, a sense of national identification often depended on the presence or absence of social institutions that promoted those identifications. Boyer analyzed the rise of Christian socialism in Vienna in terms of ward politics, testing the ways in which broader ideological constructions and political cultures grew out of specific neighborhood concerns and situational alliances. At the same time, influential studies by Austrian scholar Gerald Sturge and several of his students, most notably Emil Brix, Hannelore Burger, and Maria Kurz, interrogated the specific ways in which Habsburg imperial institutions, such as schools, the judicial system, or the Austrian census, managed practical issues surrounding linguistic diversity. These scholars' ability to tack between local examples and imperial politics undermined the notion that the existence of linguistic differences had somehow determined social relations and institutional development in the region. Instead, they showed for the first time how imperial institutions and administrative practices shaped nationalist efforts. Toward the end of the Cold War, scholars in economics, anthropology, political science, and literary studies also began to examine more critically and productively the surviving presumptions about economic backwardness or unbridgeable cultural difference that allegedly made Central and Eastern Europe somehow different from the rest of Europe. Since the late 1990s, historians of the Habsburg monarchy have often been in the forefront of European historians in developing cultural, transnational, or comparative approaches that questions some of the most tenacious binary concepts that have traditionally structured most accounts of Western versus Eastern Europe. Civic nationhood versus ethnic nationhood, developed versus backward, democratic versus authoritarian, ethnic homogeneity versus ethnic mosaic. Their work shows that these supposed oppositions largely fail when tested against evidence drawn from local society. Today, the field of Habsburg history flourishes as a site of remarkable creativity and innovation. Historians of the Habsburg monarchy have in fact taught their colleagues who study other regions in Europe a great deal about how to think about subjects like nationhood, multilingualism, indifference to nation, and perhaps most importantly, their topologies of empire and nation. What remains odd, however, is that few historians or editorial collectives have produced broader narrative histories that focus on empire rather than on nations as the moving force in the region's developmental trajectory. Several volumes in the remarkable project Die Habsburger Monarchie 1848-1918 series, published by the Austrian Academy of Sciences, for example, organize and structure their subjects by national categories. There are, of course, good reasons for maintaining such schemas. Until recently, historical research and training in Europe and the United States has remained organized largely by national schools, making it difficult to imagine an effective alternate model for a large collective project. This book asks historians to make the Habsburg Empire itself the subject of historical inquiry by foregrounding the common experiences of empire. It investigates how shared imperial institutions, administrative practices, and cultural programs helped to shape local society in every region of the empire, from the late 18th century until the first decades of the 20th century. It examines how these collective elements gave imperial citizens in every corner of the empire experiences that crossed linguistic, confessional, and regional divides, as well as chronological boundaries. Even after the Habsburg monarchy formally ceased to exist in November 1918, common elements of imperial practice continued to shape many people's expectations, whether they were about welfare benefits, military conscription, or the question of how political life should function. Prominent nationalist politicians in the successor states, from Thomas Masaryk, 1850 to 1937, in Czechoslovakia, to Alcide de Gasperi, 1881 to 1954, in Italy, or Anton Koroshets, 1872 to 1940, in Yugoslavia, were also heavily influenced by their formative experiences as important actors in imperial politics. They often adopted familiar laws, practices, and institutions for their new states. At the same time, however, they loudly rejected any legacy of empire as incompatible with democracy and national self-determination. As we shift our lens farther away from the nation-states that today dominate the map of Central and Eastern Europe to focus instead on empire as our subject, we desperately need new general narratives around which to organize our findings. We do not need a single narrative, but we do need large-scale alternative stories with the capacity to serve as branches on which we can array the superb new work of the past few decades. We cannot continue to ask students of history to read and profit intellectually from that work if at the same time we continue to fall back on basic narratives that contradict the new work. With this book, I hope to offer one possible set of alternative narratives around which to organize our changing field. Chapter 1. The Accidental Empire. The Greek or Roman father did not merely bring up a son for the family. He brought up a citizen for the republic. The young man was quickly made aware of the advantages it conferred, learning to perceive in it a perfection wanting in other states, and was naturally moved by such perfection. Josef von Sonnenfels, Über die Liebe des Vaterlandes, 1771. To make a state. In 1770, the government of Empress Maria Theresa, 1717 to 1780, sought to make an accurate count of the population in the western regions of her realm, and to apply a new system of house numbers to all towns, markets, and villages, even in the most scattered localities. Obtaining an accurate picture of the population was critical to the process of conscripting troops for the military. More importantly, however, it was crucial to accomplishing the main goal of Maria Theresa's reign, forging more effective institutions of rule to create a state. Previous attempts at obtaining an accurate count of the population in the 1760s, generally provided by parish priests or local administrators, had yielded such widely divergent and useless numbers that one of the Empress's privy councillors had exclaimed in frustration that he doubted that, with these tables, a state could be made. Nevertheless, for pressing reasons we will learn more about later, Maria Theresa had to make a state. The Habsburg government decided to remedy the deficit in its knowledge by using the military to carry out both the count and the house numbering. This option did carry with it some risks. When the military ventured into the countryside, it usually met with open hostility from local populations desperate to protect their young men from a form of military service that could last as long as 20 years. In some villages, families would hide their men or send them into the forests. In other cases, young men might mutilate their bodies, usually breaking a leg or an arm, in order to avoid the fate of forced conscription. In still other cases, a mistaken belief that the military would spare married men produced sudden waves of local marriages. Anticipating this kind of trouble, the government instructed local priests in 1770 to quiet such fears wherever they could. The priests should assure the population that this census was not tied to military conscription. The government, however, doubted the effectiveness of this measure. Much to everyone's surprise, local populations in 1770 behaved in some radically unexpected ways. In general, they treated the appearance of the military in their villages as a positive event, often greeting the soldiers with enthusiasm. Why? The government had assigned the military a critical third task as well, beyond simply counting the population and numbering its houses. It had also charged the military to investigate the condition of the local population, that is, its health, level of literacy, and the quality of local living conditions, types of housing, sanitary conditions, effectiveness of teachers, state of the local economy. Once people understood that the military would report their condition and their grievances to the empress, they welcomed the soldiers, treating them as representatives of the ruler with whom they hoped to register their particular complaints. As one officer reported from the crown land of Carniola, the people had generally behaved in a peaceful and willing manner, not for any love of a soldier's life, but in the hope that their robot, forced labor, and dues in kind would be diminished. These surprisingly positive encounters between local peasantries and a developing Austrian state capture three critical themes of this book. In the first place, these encounters offer typical examples of an 18th-century imperial regime seeking to consolidate its control over several very different territories by mapping their geographies, counting their people, numbering their houses, and for the first time, learning more about their people's living conditions. More than generating mere accounting, these state-building practices sought eventually to replace traditional local relationships of power with new loyalties that tied individuals to the central state. To do so, however, meant breaking the traditional political dominance exercised by regional power brokers, the local nobility. In 1770, for example, the central government purposely avoided delegating the tasks of counting and description to the local nobility or even to the local clergy. Rather, the regime sent its own loyal instrument, the military, to ascertain the truth. In doing so, it bypassed the local nobility to strengthen an incipient bond between the local population and the empire. Second, Maria Theresa's enumerative project reflects some fundamentally new thinking by the Habsburg dynasty and its advisers about the proper relationship between a government and its subjects, both aristocrats and commoners alike. This new relationship between ruler and ruled saw the people of the empire in essentially comparable and interchangeable terms, rather than in terms of traditional hierarchies of privileged and less privileged classes, each with different sets of rights. A third theme that we repeatedly encounter arises from how local peasants engaged with the men sent to count and describe them. In towns and villages across the monarchy, peasants repeatedly demanded access to the visiting military representatives to complain to them about local conditions. What is important here is not the specific content of the complaints. Even some representatives of the military in 1770 doubted that what they heard was completely true, but rather the popular belief that one could complain to state officials, not local notables, to redress grievances. Peasants did not harbor naive beliefs in the innate goodness of a faraway ruler who would rectify local injustices once brought to her attention. The peasants who complained to the military appear to have been well aware of the strained relations between their empress and their local landlords. They took advantage of this situation by casting their lot most enthusiastically with the central state and demonstrating a hopeful confidence in its ability to act on their behalf. Here we have an early example of local people making empire their own by using its emerging structures to argue for their own agendas. From marginal to global. A centralized Habsburg state emerged in the second half of the 18th century out of various territories acquired by the Habsburg dynasty since the 13th century. Where exactly was this emerging new state located, and what kinds of populations did it encompass in the 18th century? In the 1780s, the Habsburg dynasty's holdings stretched from today's cities of Innsbruck in the west to Lviv in the east, from Milan and Florence on the Italian peninsula to Antwerp on the North Sea and Cluj in the Carpathian Mountains, from Prague in Bohemia to Vukovar and down to Belgrade in the south. The Habsburgs held territories that today are located in 12 different European countries, and that in the late 18th century included speakers of languages known today as Croatian, Czech, Flemish, French, German, Hungarian, Italian, Ladin, Polish, Romanian, Serb, Slovak, Slovene, Ukrainian, and Yiddish. This diversity extended to religious practice as well. Although the Roman Catholic Church traditionally held a privileged place in the Habsburgs' lands, their subjects also included Orthodox Christians, Greek Catholics or Uniates, Calvinists, Lutherans, Jews, Armenian Christians, and Unitarians. This linguistic and religious diversity was typical for larger states in early modern Europe, from the Spanish or French empires in the west to the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth or the emerging Russian Empire in the east. Because of the ways in which states gained or lost territories in war, through dynastic marriages or thanks to negotiated trades, their lands did not necessarily have any historical or cultural relationships to each other, nor were they necessarily even geographically contiguous. European dynastic states also did not rest on unified administrative institutions or unified cultural practices, such as common language use, and certainly not on a shared sense of identification among a ruler's subjects. Instead, Europe's dynasties treated territorial units as family possessions, or as the fruits of military conquest to be traded at will. In most of those units, however, powerful noble families generally controlled taxation, the local administration of justice, and military conscription. Their representatives met irregularly in diets or regional parliaments. The Habsburg rulers depended on negotiations with these diets for tax revenues and military conscripts. The Habsburgs had started out as a relatively minor noble family with lands and a castle in what is today the Swiss canton of Aargau. From this small territory, the first Habsburg to achieve political fame, Count Rudolf IV, 1218 to 1291, was elected German king and Holy Roman Emperor in 1273. At the time, and until its collapse in 1806, the Holy Roman Empire was a loose confederation of large and small sovereign political states, stretching from the Italian peninsula in the south to Jutland in the north, and from contemporary France in the west to today's Poland in the east. Its nominal head, an emperor elected for life by the empire's most powerful princes, or electors, enjoyed some international prestige, social status, and cultural influence with this title. However, his largely ceremonial position gave the emperor little authority over the more than 300 political units that made up the empire. In fact, by choosing the unassuming Rudolf of Habsburg over his more impressive rivals in 1273, the electors had prevented other more powerful claimants from threatening the balance of power in Central Europe. By the end of Rudolf's reign as Holy Roman Emperor, however, the Habsburgs had managed to become key political players in Central Europe. They had added considerably to the family's territories and moved the geographic center of their holdings eastward by winning the duchies of Lower and Upper Austria, including Vienna, Styria, Carinthia, and the Margraviate of Carniola from the Babenberg family. Later, in the next century, the Habsburg family added the Principality of Tyrol to this new cluster of territories. As the family's new power base, these territories, which roughly matched today's Austria and Slovenia, became known collectively as the Habsburgs' hereditary lands, because the family established a right to permanent succession in them, while losing its Swiss holdings. Afterwards, the term Austria, from two of the duchies, came to be used for these lands. Following Rudolf's death in 1291, It was not until 1452 that another Habsburg, Frederick III, 1415 to 1493, was elected Holy Roman Emperor. During his lifetime, Frederick managed to have his son Maximilian I, 1459 to 1519, elected his successor as emperor, establishing a practice that kept the imperial title in the family, with only one short exception in the 18th century, until the dissolution of the Holy Roman Empire in 1806. Both Frederick and Maximilian expanded the family's fortunes by arranging a series of brilliant dynastic marriages. Maximilian's marriage to Mary of Burgundy brought the family the resources of one of Europe's wealthiest states. The same strategy gained for two of Maximilian's children, Philip and Margaret, the newly united Kingdom of Spain with its overseas empire. Maximilian's grandson, Philip's son, Charles V, 1500 to 1558, inherited an empire that spanned the globe, from Spain and its holdings in the Americas to Burgundy, Austria, and the Holy Roman Empire. In yet another marriage coup, Maximilian betrothed two of Charles V's siblings, Mary, 1505 to 1558, and Ferdinand, 1503 to 1564, to King Louis II of Hungary and Bohemia, and to his sister Anne, respectively. When in 1526 young King Louis of Hungary and Bohemia died in battle against the armies of the Ottoman Empire, the Hungarian and Bohemian estates, or parliaments, elected his brother-in-law Ferdinand of Habsburg to be the next King of Hungary and Bohemia. The Hungarian crown gave the Habsburgs a powerful claim to two regions historically linked to Hungary, the Kingdom of Croatia in the southwest and the Principality of Transylvania in the east. Habsburg rule in Hungary, however, remained little more than a claim, since most of Hungary and Transylvania remained under Ottoman or Ottoman-allied rule for the next 175 years. At the end of his reign in 1556, Charles V divided an unwieldy global empire between a Western or Spanish branch of the family under his son Philip II, 1527 to 1598, and an Eastern or Austrian branch under his brother, who became Emperor Ferdinand I. For the next 150 years, the Spanish and Austrian branches of the Habsburg family remained closely allied, reinforcing their special relationship with frequent intra-family marriages. When the Spanish branch of the family died out for lack of a male heir in 1700, the French king, Louis XIV, claimed the Spanish throne. A war over the succession to the Spanish throne pitted the Austrian Habsburgs and their allies against France. When the war finally ended in 1714, the Austrian Habsburgs had lost the Spanish throne to a junior branch of the French royal house. In part, the loss of the Spanish territories would facilitate the building of a territorial Habsburg state in Central Europe in the next century. Sex and the Empire. The origins of a unified Habsburg state in Central Europe, unofficially called Austria after the dynasty's core territories, date to a specific series of laws promulgated in the early 18th century and later known collectively as the Pragmatic Sanction. Ostensibly, this bundle of laws dealt with the most intimate of family affairs, the worrisome lack of a male heir. Unlike the situation in Britain, for example, where women of the Tudor and Stuart dynasties had inherited the throne, traditions originating in the so-called Salic Law restricted the succession to males in many continental European states. No woman could be elected to lead the Holy Roman Empire, although there was no reason why a woman could not rule in the territories the Habsburgs held directly. In formal terms, however, the Habsburgs held their core Austrian lands as a fief from the Holy Roman Emperor, and if that position passed out of the family, would another emperor challenge their rule in their own territories? Given that his two sons, Joseph I, 1678 to 1711, and Charles VI, 1685 to 1740, had so far fathered either daughters or no children at all, Emperor Leopold I, 1640 to 1705, feared that the Austrian branch of the dynasty would die out the way its Spanish counterpart had in 1701. In 1703, Leopold decreed the Pactum Mutui Successionis that forbade the monarchy's partition and allowed that in the absence of a male heir, a female descendant could rule the core Habsburg lands. In 1713, Charles VI altered Leopold's agreement to place his own two daughters ahead of his deceased elder brother's daughter. The various diets ratified this agreement swiftly. Fears that the end of the Habsburg dynasty could bring war and instability to the region made this pragmatic sanction more attractive to the diets, which might otherwise have rejected it as an encroachment on their prerogatives. They all agreed that barring the miraculous appearance of a male heir, when Charles VI died, they would confirm his elder daughter Maria Theresa as their ruler. Charles then spent considerable political and financial capital trying to persuade the other European powers to accept the arrangement, while paradoxically doing nothing to prepare his daughter Maria Theresa for her impending royal responsibilities. As intimately bound up with problems of reproduction as these laws may have been, they turned out later to have had another more critical aspect. The pragmatic sanction was the first significant piece of legislation that treated what could be called a composite monarchy, the diverse territories under Habsburg rule, including the kingdoms of Bohemia and Hungary, as indivisible and inseparable, that is, as a single political unit. At this time, the Habsburgs' territorial holdings were indeed geographically more consolidated than they had been a century earlier, although they still included some non-contiguous territories in the Netherlands and on the Italian peninsula. After 1700, contemporary cartographers had begun to refer more frequently to a Greater Austria, meaning more than simply the duchies of Lower and Upper Austria, and to the Habsburgs as the House of Austria. Mirroring Charles VI and Maria Theresa's state-building efforts, maps of Central Europe increasingly centered their depictions of the Habsburgs' lands on Austrian Vienna, rather than on the Holy Roman Empire with its capital at Frankfurt, although the latter remained the source of their most illustrious title. Yet if contemporaries gradually came to view the Habsburgs' territories as a single state called Austria, this statehood was hardly rooted in institutional realities. Accustomed as we are to the institutional and administrative homogeneity claimed by territorial nation-states today, we might be tempted to see the Habsburgs' territories on those maps around 1700 as forming a coherent whole. This presumption would be erroneous. The character and extent of Habsburg rule differed substantially from place to place within the borders of their lands. The Habsburgs exercised direct control over fiscal, administrative, and judicial institutions in their hereditary lands, Lower and Upper Austria, Styria, Carinthia, Carniola, and Tyrol, through an Austrian chancellery located in Vienna. By 1700, they wielded almost as much control over their Bohemian crown lands, Bohemia, Moravia, Silesia. They did not seek to exert such systematic control over their territories on the Italian peninsula. They exerted the least amount of control over Hungary, whose nobles resisted Habsburg efforts to incorporate it into a larger common state after its conquest from the Ottomans. Although in the long run the pragmatic sanction became the legal basis for a unitary Habsburg state, in the short run Charles VI's efforts to gain its acceptance by Europe's opportunistic powers failed dramatically. When Charles died in 1740, his 23-year-old daughter, Maria Theresa, 1717-1780, immediately found herself under attack by rapacious neighbors. Seeing a rare opportunity, Frederick II of Prussia, 1712-1786, known as the Great, invaded the rich and highly populated province of Silesia. At the same time, Elector Charles Albert of Bavaria, 1697-1745, with the support of the French, the Saxons, and a part of the Bohemian nobility in the Diet, laid claim to neighboring Bohemia and had himself elected Holy Roman Emperor as Charles VII over Maria Theresa's husband, Francis Stephen of Lorraine, 1708-1765. With no other available option, the beleaguered Maria Theresa began her reign by making concessions to the Hungarian nobility. She needed funds, she needed troops, and she needed both immediately. In 1741, she had herself crowned King of Hungary, and at a meeting of the Hungarian Diet in Pressburg, Pozsony, she sought financial and military assistance. Dressed in white and gold, the Hungarian colors of the time, and contrary to later depictions and descriptions, without her six-month-old son, Josef, present, she exhibited him to the Diet 9 days later, Maria Theresa made an emotional appeal, swearing to uphold the Diet's privileges. The very existence of the Kingdom of Hungary, of our own person, of our children, and of our crown are now at stake. Now that we are forsaken by all, our sole resource is the fidelity, arms, and long-tried valour of the Hungarians. In regard to ourself, the faithful estates and orders of Hungary will enjoy our hearty cooperation. Her entreaty elicited offers of life and blood to our King Maria Theresa by the assembled notables, although less well known was the hard bargaining that preceded this outpouring of loyalty. Thanks largely to Hungarian support, Maria Theresa swiftly changed the fortunes of war, turning the tables on the Bavarians by capturing their capital of Munich at the end of 1741. The Austrians regained Bohemia, Moravia, and a small part of Silesia, as well as defeating the Bavarians and the French, whose harsh occupation policies had in any event alienated their would-be Bohemian allies. In 1745, with the death of Charles Albert of Bavaria, Maria Theresa had her husband, Francis Stephen, elected Holy Roman Emperor. In 1748, the Treaty of Aachen officially ended the War of the Austrian Succession. Maria Theresa had successfully held off all challenges to her rights, but she had lost most of Silesia, her most economically valuable province, to Prussia. Her country's military and financial unpreparedness for war made it clear to Maria Theresa that she must reform her state, and quickly too, if it was to remain a great power in 18th century Europe. She would also need a new series of alliances to help her win back Silesia from Prussia. She would have to create a standing army that could compete effectively with Prussia's reformed military, and she would have to integrate her territories into a far more effective unitary state. Maria Theresa never did regain Silesia, but certainly not for lack of trying. In the 1750s, she and her foreign minister, Count, later Prince Wenzel Anton Kaunitz, 1711-1794, orchestrated something of a diplomatic revolution in Central Europe. Abandoning Britain, Austria allied itself to its traditional enemy, France, for the first time in centuries, an alliance that was eventually embodied, literally, in the marriage of Maria Theresa's youngest daughter, Maria Antonia, 1755-1793, to the future King Louis XVI of France. This strategic transformation was aimed especially against Prussia. Only Maria Theresa's obsessive desire to regain Silesia allowed her to overcome her powerful anti-French prejudices. The failure to regain Silesia in the Seven Years' War, 1756-1763, however, left Austria with a nominal French alliance, and with far greater concerns in the East, where Imperial Russia sought aggressively to expand at the expense of its neighbours, the Ottoman Empire, Sweden, and the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. In fact, it was on the Eastern Front that Maria Theresa eventually gained territorial compensation for the loss of Silesia. In 1772, she partook, albeit reluctantly, with Frederick II of Prussia and Catherine II, the Great, of Russia, in the first partition of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. Using that state's alleged internal disorder as a pretext, these three neighboring powers divided about 30% of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth's territory among themselves. Although Maria Theresa had originally criticized Russian and Prussian intentions with respect to the Commonwealth, the word partition repels me, her foreign minister, Kaunitz, nevertheless made certain that she received a significant share of the spoils. The new territory was christened, in Latin, the Kingdom of Galicia and Lodomeria, after the medieval Rus principalities of Halych and Vladimir, which the Hungarian crown had claimed in the 12th century. Along with her state-building impulses, Maria Theresa clearly knew the value of mobilizing her family's mythic history to overcome any scruples about taking new territories. State-building and reform. In 1748, immediately following the War of the Austrian Succession, Maria Theresa implemented a barrage of administrative reforms to strengthen her military and to create a more effective and centralized state. Her state chancellor, Count Friedrich Wilhelm von Haugwitz, 1702-1765, forced the diets of the hereditary lands to increase their tax contributions to the military budget, while creating a standing army of some 108,000 men. Additionally, Haugwitz compelled the individual diets of those lands to grant the government these funds for 10-year periods rather than annually, thus diminishing their ability to bargain with the state when it needed military funds. Continuing the institutional process of making formally autonomous kingdoms into provinces of a central state, local and provisional administrators were increasingly made responsible to Vienna rather than to the various diets. In 1749, Haugwitz merged the Bohemian Chancellery with its counterpart that administered the hereditary lands. In 1751, Maria Theresa created a single supreme court located in Vienna for both the Bohemian and Austrian lands. Over the next decades, the government continued to experiment with institutions designed to centralize administration of the state. Vigorous provincial opposition often forced Maria Theresa to modify or postpone implementing these proposals, but her government doggedly kept up its efforts, often proposing yet new sets of institutions. In their pursuit of territorial integration and centralization, the 18th century Habsburgs and their advisers did not follow a single model of state building. The remarkable reform rulers of the 18th century, Empress Maria Theresa, 1770 to 1780, and her sons, the Empress Joseph II, 1741 to 1790, and Leopold II, 1747 to 1792, developed ad hoc ideas about how best to unite their territories more effectively. All three shared fundamental long-term goals: to stabilize state finances by taxing the nobility, to raise productivity among peasant producers by relaxing or ending feudal relations, to encourage the expansion of domestic industry, trade, travel, and communication networks, to diminish regional guild restrictions on manufacture, to promote the moral and practical education of their subjects, and to reform the Catholic Church by bringing religious practice under state control. Like some of their contemporaries in Europe, these three ambitious Habsburg rulers have often been called enlightened despots. The term refers in part to their assertions of absolute centralized power as the means to reform the state and to transform the societies over which they ruled. Absolutism, or despotism, for these monarchs specifically references their refusal to share power with the nobility. The term enlightenment refers to a loose set of intellectual networks and cultural movements across Europe in the late 17th and 18th centuries that celebrated the growth of knowledge and encouraged its explicit application to social institutions and political structures in order to improve the condition of humanity. The 18th century saw a veritable explosion of published works of literature, science, history, religion, and philosophy in the territories ruled by the Habsburgs. 18th century European society also experienced an explosion in literacy rates and an increase in public social settings, and not simply elite ones, where such ideas might be openly read, discussed, and debated. The Enlightenment interest in science and in humanist studies also made explicitly secular approaches to governing more possible in a world still dominated by religious institutions and cultures. At the same time, however, religious and moral questions remained at the heart of Enlightenment concerns. While Maria Theresa and her sons debated policy with their advisers in far more utilitarian and functionalist terms than had their predecessors, and while they sought advice from a range of educated secular experts, they nevertheless continued to acknowledge the fundamental value of religion to society. The rise both of literacy and of interregional networks of humanistic and scientific research made it possible for all kinds of people to comment on or argue publicly and privately with the broader processes of reform undertaken by the monarchs. Although noble-dominated diets and noble commentators had long been able to make their varied opinions known, it was in the 18th century that people from the commercial, administrative, and entrepreneurial professions also began to articulate their interests and attitudes publicly towards state policies. During the second half of the century, local society in cities and towns like Vienna, Prague, Brünn, Brno, Kaschau, Kassa, and Pressburg, Pozsonje, created new kinds of sites of public discussion, from coffee houses to semi-public salons to museums. Here, members of middle-class society met or might occasionally rub shoulders with aristocrats while exchanging opinions about the religious, philosophical, and artistic questions of the day. Soon after the municipal government of Kassa erected a town theatre in 1781, for example, the city fathers undertook alterations specifically to establish a coffee house on the north side of the building. By the 1790s, sites of sociability like coffee houses or scientific societies in towns or agricultural clubs in the countryside enabled their members to debate and develop original policy ideas. As we will see, these settings served as models for the many voluntary associations that exploded on the urban scene in the early 19th century. Equally important when it came to the transformation of Enlightenment ideas into political, social, economic, or cultural programs were the many Freemasons' lodges that sprang up in the Habsburg lands starting in the 1740s. Thanks in part to the support of Maria Theresa's husband, Francis Stephen, who was himself a Mason, lodges with thousands of members established themselves during this period despite the vocal disapproval of the papacy. The lodges were not exactly sites of social equality, nor were they particularly secular in character. By the 1770s, a good number of the Austrian Masons were themselves priests who wanted to see the Catholic Church purged of what they termed old-fashioned or intolerant attitudes. The lodges also afforded their members settings where they might debate and test all kinds of reform ideas. In Hungary, it was largely Protestant religious thinkers, writers, and aristocrats who engaged with Enlightenment ideas to develop and promote reform programs. Thus, it was not simply urban-based Freemasonry that offered sites for sociability and debate. In Bohemia, for example, local notables organized agrarian societies designed both to spread knowledge about modern agricultural techniques to ordinary peasants and to circulate information about new technologies or new crops among their wealthier members. The contemporary theories of political economy, whose merits were debated in pamphlet literature, in salons, and in agrarian societies and Freemason lodges, offered the Habsburgs many possible models for reform. The physiocrats, for example, located prosperity specifically in the agricultural wealth produced by a prosperous peasant population. Mercantilists, on the other hand, promoted local industries and regulated international trade through a policy of protective tariffs. Cameralists sought to reorganize government institutions by dividing and designating specific functions for them, such as ministries in a cabinet, to make them more efficient and effective. Central European Jansenists promoted improved public morality through the spread of a vigorous, reformed, and far less Jesuitical form of Catholicism. The point that matters is this. New social actors engaged in fierce intellectual debates about politics, economics, and society, and in so doing produced an ideological apparatus in service of reform-minded monarchs. If the scale of the reform programs contemplated by the Habsburg rulers seemed challenging for such a large empire, at least they could now call upon self-proclaimed men of science to conceptualize and justify specific reform programs by referring to empirical studies of real conditions. As we heard at the beginning of this chapter, the 18th century was not simply an age of philosophy and science. It was also an age of information gathering, of mapping, of statistical studies of all kinds. The ultimate function of all of these applied forms of knowledge, like that of the enlightened despot, was to serve the general well-being of state and society. The expanding and increasingly centralized bureaucracies of the 18th century continued to employ many of the regional nobles who might otherwise have lost political influence as the diets gradually ceded more areas of competence to Vienna. In the case of Bohemia, for example, Maria Theresa even retained the services of several Bohemian nobles who had momentarily abandoned her for the Bavarians in 1741, installing them in both the provincial and central bureaucracies. The ambitious character of the reform programs produced a sharp increase in civil servants' administrative reach into society. It also produced a growing demand for new servants of the state to take on a rapidly expanding workload. In Hungary, during Maria Theresa's reign, the ruling council saw its workload rise by 400%, while the numbers of officials who dealt with correspondence alone rose from 50 to over 120. Clearly, administrative change required more and better-educated state employees to manage reform. Although nobles and aristocrats usually occupied the highest echelons of this expanding bureaucracy, educated sons of the middle classes were increasingly filling positions at the middle and lower levels. Moreover, Maria Theresa handed out more patents of nobility than ever before to commoners who earned distinction through their service to the state. During her term, almost 40% of all the people who gained a patent of nobility came from the expanding bureaucracy. At the same time, the need to maintain an expanded military forced Maria Theresa to end the tax exemptions enjoyed by the nobility and the church in her Bohemian and Austrian lands in 1748. This critical measure undermined the traditional social privileges enjoyed by the nobility, even though the state assessed noble and church lands at a lower rate than peasant-owned lands. Maria Theresa also used fiscal policy to promote interregional and international trade. She maintained the privileged tax status that her father had conferred upon the crowns of Trieste, Trst, really a fishing village, and Fiume, Rijeka, on the Adriatic in 1719. This status freed the town's merchants from liability for normal duties on goods exported and imported through the city, and thereby gave them an incentive to bring their businesses there. With the loss of most of Silesia to Prussia in 1741, Maria Theresa's government also hoped to redirect more commerce away from northern trade routes through Hamburg, as far possible southward through Trieste, Trst, and Fiume, Rijeka. As a result, both towns grew rapidly into cities over the course of the 18th century, and both competed with Venice for Mediterranean trade in the 1760s. By the end of the century, a third of the monarchy's exports passed through Trieste, Trst alone, and the town's population surpassed 30,000. Eventually, Trieste, Trst became the fourth largest city in the monarchy and one of Europe's busiest commercial ports. Meanwhile, in 1779, at the eastern edge of her lands, Maria Theresa conferred free trade privileges comparable to those enjoyed by Trieste, Trst, and Fiume, Rijeka on another critical entrepôt, the Galician town of Brody. Brody's incorporation into the Habsburg monarchy as part of the new Kingdom of Galicia had at first threatened the town's status as a wealthy trading post in a critical east-west network that stretched from Leipzig to Odessa and the Crimea. As a result of Brody's incorporation into Austria, its merchants, mostly Jews, now had to cross several new borders in order to maintain their former trading relationships, and each border crossing required payments of import and export duties. Not wishing to weaken the town's comparative economic advantage, the Habsburg government conferred the special status of a free trade zone on Brody and its surrounding villages, enabling merchants to exchange their goods there without having to pay duties. In making this decision, Vienna officials had explicitly debated whether to treat Brody as a free seaport, Freier Seehafen, similar to the monarchy's existing Adriatic free ports of Trieste, Trst, and Fiume, Rijeka. Their thinking on the issue rested on larger questions of empire-wide economic development, and not simply on the parochial interests of Galicia. Vienna worried that without a favorable tax status, Brody's merchants would decide to move their businesses across the border to neighboring towns in what remained of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. At the same time, however, the new Galician administration protested vigorously against the privileges granted to the town because it hoped to tax Brody's lucrative trade for itself. Many of Vienna's economic policies also reinforced the regime's political goal to integrate the Habsburgs' diverse territorial units more effectively into a larger whole. In 1775, for example, after years of planning, negotiation, and wrangling, the government united the hereditary lands with the Bohemian lands under a single tariff regime at their borders, allowing complete freedom of trade inside the new borders for the first time. Galicia was next in line for this common tariff regime, but Vienna worried that its comparative economic weakness and the necessity to reorient regional trade networks and relationships after the partition made it too vulnerable as yet to participate in a large free trade zone. Political thinkers in 18th century Europe frequently argued that the military capabilities of a state depended directly on society's economic prosperity. So we cannot understand the full range of Maria Theresa's reforms if we view her state-building policies purely in terms of administrative and fiscal reform. She also sought to improve peasant productivity, to introduce new industries by diminishing local guild powers, and to expand Austria's share of international trade. Since economies in 18th century continental Europe ultimately rested on the productivity and wealth of the peasantry, and because the peasantry bore most of the tax burden, the state took an increasing interest in improving the situation of the peasantry. Countless contemporary observers blamed the fiscal instability of the Habsburg state precisely on the economic inefficiency of the existing organization of rural society. In most of the territories Maria Theresa governed, peasants were legally and practically bound to the local estate owners. Not only did landowners demand cash or produce from the peasants who leased their lands, but landowners also claimed a certain number of days' labor from the peasants per week, the hated institution known as the robot. The exact number of such days varied considerably by territory, but in many parts of Galicia and Hungary, it was more than 3 days a week, creating a situation that, as one contemporary noted, makes it impossible for the peasant to cultivate his own plot. None other than Maria Theresa's son Joseph II made the crucial observation on his first trip to Galicia in 1773 that the people are so busy with robot that their corn remains unharvested and is totally neglected and lost. In some regions, the law also prevented peasants from migrating elsewhere and even forbade them to marry without the landlord's consent. Moreover, if a peasant wished to challenge his treatment at the hands of his landlord, it was usually the latter who served as the local judge. Taken altogether, one could argue, as did many of Maria Theresa's advisers, that the peasants lacked fundamental control over their own bodies, something the religiously inclined empress also worried must eventually twist their moral character as well as limit their life chances. These constraints on peasant freedom and productivity might best be viewed comparatively in the context of a broad variety of contemporary forms of unfree labor, ranging from serfdom in imperial Russia to plantation slavery in Europe's American and Caribbean colonies. Still, it was first and foremost fiscal need, rather than moral outrage, that drove the Vienna government to take on the improvement of agricultural productivity in the territories it governed. Financial considerations also led to perhaps the most unintentionally radical of Maria Theresa's reform efforts, and one that was only fully realized by her sons Joseph II and Leopold II after her death: the modification, if not the complete abrogation, of the institutions that bound most peasants to the landed nobility. Believing that nobles, peasants, and state would all benefit from making peasants into more productive and independent individuals, Maria Theresa sought to transform the labor and crops that peasants owed to their lords into fixed cash payments to be shared by the landowners and the state. Independent peasants should control their own destinies as legally, economically, and morally free individuals. They should eventually own their own plots of land, wherever possible. Nobles who needed peasant labor to farm their estates would eventually be able to hire landless peasants for a wage. Noble landowners would give up personal control over the peasantry, along with their rights to unpaid peasant labor, to the administration of local justice and to their own tax-free status. Maria Theresa could not simply impose such a radical change on society anywhere in Austria, nor was it her intention to act radically. She preferred a process of negotiation and compromise. Still, she implemented as much of this model reform as she could, especially on those lands she and her family owned directly. Although she failed to impose a full change on all of her lands, even the fact that she limited the amount of unpaid labor the nobles could demand from the peasantry began to undermine the very logic behind traditional social hierarchies. Pamphlet literature and public debates in the 1760s and 1770s increasingly asked what the rights and obligations of a future free peasantry would look like. In doing so, the authors helped to shape debate over what was possible or desirable. The government also began work on a new civil law code that wrestled with the concept of the peasant as a free individual. By the 1790s, as we will see, the logic of reform pushed the regime ever closer to adopting a single concept of equal and active legal citizenship for all inhabitants of the realms, regardless of their social rank. In 1799, after the demise of all three of the Habsburg reform monarchs, a draft law for Galicia could state that every citizen, regardless of rank, estate, stand, or sex, is obligated to promote the general well-being of the state through careful obedience to its laws. This formula straddles two very different concepts of society. One version was divided socially and culturally by estate or privileged class. The other, still in the making, was a world of citizens who would be equal in their obligations to the state and in the rights they received from it. Peasants speak. As we heard at the opening of this chapter, the state had traditionally depended for information about the population on irregular reports of births, marriages, and deaths generated by parish priests. Given the succession of wars fought by Maria Theresa, military demand for ever-increasing numbers of healthy recruits drove the development of new census technologies for determining the size of local populations as well as their distinctive qualities. The military leadership of the mid-18th century emerged as a powerful and influential source of support for a range of social, political, and economic reforms, in part because it too was interested in more than simply raising the numbers of recruits. The physical condition of recruits was as much a concern as their numbers. For this reason, several military leaders shared Maria Theresa's skepticism about the economic efficiency and low productivity levels engendered by traditional relations on the land, and instead strongly supported her ideal of a legally emancipated and economically free peasantry. When a census was taken in 1770 to determine the size, health, and educational levels of local populations in the hereditary and Bohemian lands, or when Habsburg territories had to be mapped, often for the first time, it was the military that developed new techniques. Only the military could draw on large enough numbers of men to carry out such projects successfully. The armies of civilian bureaucrats and civil servants that would later blanket the Central European landscape did not yet exist. Thanks largely to their active participation in local recruitment and data-gathering projects, both the military leadership and many rank-and-file officers also developed a profound sympathy for the plight of the peasantry throughout Austria. The Hofkriegsrat, or War Ministry, claimed in 1770 that its broader aim in taking the census was to aid the servile people to become more rational, more sober, cleaner, more affluent, and happier. One innovation introduced in 1770 was the imposition of house numbering systems in villages and towns to maintain more accurate records about their inhabitants in the long term. Military assessors who travelled to each locality did not simply count the population, dividing it by sex and age, nor did they simply assign numbers to the smallest huts and largest townhouses depending on the route they took as they travelled through a town. More important by far, the assessors also served as eyes and ears for the central government, collecting information from each locality about 14 different topics of potential interest, including health and hygiene, education levels, degree of religious piety, level of affluence, and the general public mood. The officers who carried out the census in 1770 to 1771 were explicitly ordered not to encourage peasant complaints. Nevertheless, as we heard at the outset of this chapter, they heard an earful. In Styria, the assessors reported, "A general complaint is the high amount of robot that makes it impossible for the peasant to work his own plot of land and to pay his dues, both to the government and to the landowner." Around the town of Celia, in South Styria, conditions were so bad that the assessors noted, "Many houses are empty and much land has been deserted." Peasants in this region had found themselves forced to abandon house and land and to seek a living with their families as farmhands in neighboring Croatia. In Carniola, just to the west, the population generally cooperated willingly during the census, from the hope of gaining a reduction in the robot and the dues in kind. In Bohemia, tenants on the estates of Count Palm complained specifically about the severity of the robot requirements. In the winter season, they must give 3 days every week, but in the summer they owe work every day with the oxen, and in addition to this, another one or two persons must perform manual labor. In the district of Leitmeritz, Litomirzhitsa, complaints only came to us in secret. There, the assessor hinted that an objective investigation would bring to light many misdemeanors by landowners. Local authorities were quick to defend themselves from peasant complaints, accusing peasants of gross exaggeration and general willfulness. In the southern Bohemian town of Klatau, Klatovy, for example, one officer reported that peasants clearly would have made even more complaints to him had not a local order suddenly come down that they were not to turn to any military officer with complaints. In Styria, officers objected that in one district, the local landlord himself sought to hinder their questioning of the peasants. In fact, in both Bohemia and Moravia, where peasant rebellions broke out sporadically in the 1770s, officials on local estates complained that the military census and process of house numbering fostered a dangerous sense of freedom and emancipation from local authorities among the peasants. In 1770, it seems, many peasants thought of the central state or imperial power as a handy counterweight to the authority of the local nobility. Although in institutional terms that state barely existed as yet at the local level, it clearly held great symbolic meaning to peasants who aggressively asserted their desires to its military representatives. Peasants in many regions invested a deep commitment, at least situationally, to the Habsburg dynasty and its central institutions, seeing in them a means to protect and further their social interests. Thus, the distance of the empire from its many constituent territories, along with the diversity of those territories, could paradoxically produce new kinds of attachments to it, as the empire's agents appeared to stand between local notables and peasants. The emancipation of the peasant from the direct influence of the local nobility also demanded the creation of educational institutions. Peasants required training both in the latest agricultural techniques and, perhaps more importantly, in moral strictures, so that under transformed circumstances they would remain orderly, respectful of authority, and diligent in carrying out their duties. That same military survey of 1770 to 1771 repeatedly highlighted peasant illiteracy as a cause of much poverty and social misery. Illiteracy in turn was blamed on the neglect of schools by local authorities, on the insufficient numbers of teachers, or on the impossible burdens with which the teachers were charged. In South Styria in 1771, the surveyors observed, "In each of the parishes a school teacher has been funded and hired, but the immense spread of the parishes, the dispersal of houses in the parishes, and the fact that the school teacher is also employed by the parish and the church for other tasks, leaves him too little time to give the children their necessary lessons. Thus, very few peasants can actually read. In fact, quite a few of them do not even know their names or their ages." Similarly, surveyors in Bohemia noted with disapproval that too little thought is given to the schools. They do not make a priority of hiring qualified schoolteachers. Thanks to the heedless neglect of the parents, the young children go bad in several ways. In 1774, 1777 in Hungary, Maria Theresa established a general education requirement for children of both sexes. From then on, all children between the ages of 6 and 12 throughout the monarchy would have to attend school. At least on paper, if not in practice, this system of mandatory public schooling suddenly placed the Habsburg state in the forefront of European developments in education. This legislation focused more on the education of Austria's least enlightened classes, however, than on developing Austria's institutions of higher learning. Maria Theresa's initiative did not generally aim to create intellectual academies or to expand existing university faculties. In larger towns and provincial centers, the government did add teacher training programs. Maria Theresa also created some new Latin high schools and technical training schools in fields such as mining and metallurgy, as well as an Oriental academy in Vienna to teach languages and train interpreters, mostly to produce potential officials and experts for her expanding bureaucracy. But on the whole, her education policy aimed to reach the lowest classes. She hoped to provide the peasantry the requisite moral and economic training to become productive and orderly members of society. but she did not want to give them so much education that they themselves might question the order of religion or the state. The law's main accomplishment was to establish several one- or two-class primary schools in vernacular languages across the monarchy. Given the relatively modest goals of these schools, the use of the vernacular was deemed appropriate and necessary, since few children would have understood other languages. In the 18th century, most of the teachers who staffed these new primary schools, when they were established at all, were local members of the clergy. It could hardly have been otherwise anywhere in Europe, given that the local priests were often the only individuals with even a smattering of education, especially in more remote rural villages. Nevertheless, the reliance on the clergy for the provision of a basic education to all children forces us to consider the role of the church in determining the content of education, as well as the Habsburgs' broader institutional relationship to the church in the 18th century. How did the clergy understand this additional responsibility, given that the state already relied on local clergy for onerous burdens of official record-keeping of birth, death, marriage, and conscription? Making local priests into the instrument of educational reform did not necessarily mean that mandatory primary education would be steeped in the conservative strictures of Baroque Counter-Reformation Catholicism, as it undoubtedly would have a century earlier. In the 16th century, the Catholic Church had introduced highly emotional, highly visual, and ritually demonstrative forms of Catholic worship as tools to combat the growth of popular Protestantism in Austria. Two centuries later, however, many Catholics rejected this kind of overt religiosity. Instead, they sought far simpler forms of devotion that focused more on internal personal piety and good works than on dramatically externalized ceremonial forms of devotion. Maria Theresa's personal religious practice shared a great deal with this form of simpler Catholicism that spread both in Hungary and Austria during the 18th century. This Catholicism emphasized simple, modest, and pietist virtues in everyday life, while avoiding the overtly emotional excesses of Baroque ritual practice. During Maria Theresa's reign, many Catholic thinkers, officials, and orders supported the government's increasing interference in church policy. Thus, the precise character of church influence on public education depended a great deal on the attitudes of the local priest, who might well engage at a rudimentary level with this or that development in the humanities, natural sciences, and jurisprudence, or with Enlightenment attitudes towards education in general. Maria Theresa's more radical advisers gradually convinced her to impose state supervision over the church in all matters save the purely spiritual, from the education of priests in state-run seminaries to the appointment of bishops. The regime attacked the influence of the Jesuit order in the universities, but more importantly, it took over the task of censorship from the church in 1752. As a result, the government index of banned works soon differed substantially from the church's index. The government drastically reduced the number of recognized religious holidays and dissolved contemplative orders whose members did not serve a charitable purpose in the community, appropriating their property to help fund local educational and welfare institutions. On the whole, the government reduced many, but by no means all, of the Catholic Church's privileges, increasingly treating it as one of many legitimate private associations that demanded some regulation by the state. At the same time, however, her personal sympathies for Reformed Catholicism prevented Maria Theresa from sympathizing with the radically secular logic propounded by many of her advisers, and later by her sons Joseph II and Leopold II. Throughout her reign, for example, she vigorously opposed the principle of religious toleration for Protestant or Eastern Orthodox sects, much less for Jews. As a devout Catholic, she did not see how the toleration of other religions could possibly improve her subjects' moral character. And members of the Catholic Church retained considerable privileges over other religions, such as the rights to worship publicly, to build churches with towers, and to ring church bells. Maria Theresa was not beyond contradicting her own preferences when it suited a critical policy objective, such as the encouragement of commerce in the free port city of Trieste, Trst. There she promoted immigration by merchant communities, including specifically Jews, Greek Orthodox, Armenians, and Greek Catholic uniates. After the Empress's death, her son Joseph extended this policy to Protestants. Starting with the Jews in 1746, each of these religious minorities in the city was permitted to form a corporate body to organize worship and schools among its members and to enjoy the same civil and economic rights as local Catholic merchants. Whatever her narrower intentions had been in the 1740s, by the 1770s, Maria Theresa's reform efforts had in some way reshaped almost every conceivable aspect of public life and policy. From religious practice to education to the administration of justice, from farming techniques to the creation of new manufactures, from the construction of more effective networks of roads and canals to the encouragement of sea and overland trade. Hungary and the Habsburgs. For over 200 years, the Habsburgs had spent many of their resources trying to conquer Hungary from Ottoman occupation, defending themselves from further Ottoman attacks, and after finally defeating the Ottomans, trying to establish greater political control over Hungary, Croatia, and Transylvania. Eventually, their conquest of Hungary gave the Habsburgs an opportunity to redraw somewhat the constitutional balance of power between themselves and Hungary's powerful nobility. In 1687, in recognition of Habsburg efforts to liberate Hungary, the Diet conceded to the Habsburgs a hereditary right of succession to the throne. The Habsburgs also created a zone of direct administrative control for themselves in a long strip of territory that ran along the border with the Ottoman Empire in southern Hungary, Croatia, and Transylvania, known as the military frontier. They populated this frontier with largely Eastern Orthodox Christian refugees from Ottoman rule, who received tax privileges in return for their commitment to defend the frontier against attack from the south. Yet in the 18th century, the Habsburgs lacked the financial resources to establish full administrative control over Hungary. One clear sign of this weakness was their inability to root out the considerable pockets of Calvinist, Lutheran, and Unitarian communities and their aristocratic supporters that continued to flourish in Transylvania and Upper Hungary. In consequence, Hungary remained religiously far more diverse than the dynasty's other holdings. Periodic local rebellions in Hungary until 1715, continued sporadic wars against the Ottomans until 1739, and the dynasty's dependence on the surviving Hungarian nobility to serve as local administrators also meant that Hungary retained a distinctive place among the Habsburgs' holdings. In Hungary, it was not simply the Diet that regularly asserted independence from the Habsburgs, but also the local administrations run by noble-elected county governments. During the long Ottoman presence, when a central government had all but vanished from most regions of Hungary, these county governments had shouldered the difficult burdens of local administration, justice, and even military defense. Throughout the period of administrative reorganization that followed the Habsburg conquest of Hungary, neither the dynasty nor the Catholic Church had the necessary resources to impose completely new political or religious structures on Hungary. Despite their redistribution of property and encouragement of resettlement in central Hungary and their establishment of the so-called military frontiers in the south. In fact, during the 18th century, county governments in Hungary became critical bastions of opposition to the Habsburg administration, and even consulted each other to develop common strategies of resistance to the king. On what ideological grounds did Hungarian institutions justify their opposition to their king's attempts at centralization? In the 18th century, both the Diet and county governments referred to themselves collectively, in Latin, their traditional language of business, as the Natio Hungarica, or Hungarian nation. They argued that this historic nationhood gave them certain shared rights. At the coronation ceremony, every king of Hungary had to swear an oath to respect the collective rights of this Hungarian nation. But what did the term nation mean to an 18th century public? In Hungary, nation referred to a small minority of the king's subjects indeed. The Natio Hungarica was constituted from those members of the nobility who sat in the two chambers of the Diet, those who had the right to elect its deputies, and those who also, by definition, remained exempt from taxation. Most subjects of the King of Hungary, however, and indeed most people who lived within Hungary's borders, were not considered members of the Hungarian nation. In its arguments against the king, the nation championed a vision of Hungary as an independent state whose ruler coincidentally happened to rule several other separate territories as well. Hungary, the nation argued, was most definitely not a component part of a larger Habsburg state, just as it did not belong to the Holy Roman Empire the way Bohemia did, for example. Nor, claimed the Hungarian nation, did Hungary desire to be part of any administrative structures common to other lands the Habsburg king ruled. Thanks in part to specific references made by the French political philosopher Montesquieu and his 1748 Spirit of the Laws after a visit to Hungary, the 18th century Hungarian nobility also began to claim that, taken together, its traditional national rights made up an age-old unwritten constitution. The Diet cited this revered, ancient, and invented constitution to lend even greater legal persuasiveness to its arguments against full incorporation into a Habsburg state. The Habsburg kings, on the other hand, sought to coordinate the administration of Hungary with the rest of their monarchy. The kings thus cited other ancient Hungarian constitutional traditions that gave them broad executive and judicial powers and an undisputed right to raise an army for the country's defense. When the king fought Hungary's enemies, his military constituted a single coordinated force and not separate Austrian, Bohemian, or Hungarian armies. Hungarian diets had traditionally accepted this claim. With the exception of educational reform, Maria Theresa treated almost every matter of governance differently when it came to Hungary. Her personal relationship to Hungary was tinged most obviously by the gratitude she felt throughout her reign for the critical support the Hungarian Diet had offered her in her moment of abject weakness. She expressed great pride in her Hungarian title of king, which, unlike her other titles, such as that of empress, she shared neither with her husband, Francis Stephen, nor her son, Joseph. These considerations tempered Maria Theresa's centralizing efforts, made her willing to leave Hungary somewhat separate from the rest of her state, and encouraged her to seek negotiated solutions with Hungary rather than forcing her cause. Structurally, at least, during a half century of intensive reform projects, Hungary remained somewhat peripheral to the institutional developments that unified the rest of the Habsburg state. To be clear, this period also saw considerable state-building activity within Hungary. As in her other lands, Maria Theresa expanded state services in Hungary, centralized the administration, and managed it more professionally. In Hungary, however, where administrative offices remained restricted to the nobility, the expansion of the central bureaucracy did not diminish the powers of the local nobility by empowering a cadre of commoner bureaucrats. Hungarian aristocrats also occupied the administrative positions in Vienna that governed Hungarian affairs. With only one notable exception, the military, administrative reform in Hungary tended to reinforce that society's separateness from the rest of the Habsburg monarchy. Maria Theresa constantly needed funds for her reforms and for her wars. Yet in her 40 years on the throne, she summoned the Hungarian Diet to meet only 3 times, thereby avoiding potentially difficult conflicts with the elite Hungarian nation. In 1767, however, Maria Theresa did introduce the radical herbarium laws to regulate the treatment of peasants by their lords in Hungary. Uncharacteristically, she took up this thorny issue in Hungary before she took it up in the rest of the monarchy, in part because severe agrarian revolts had broken out in Western Hungary in the early 1760s, and in part as a way to impose her will on a recalcitrant Diet. Maria Theresa's sentimental attitude toward the gallant Hungarians who had rescued her in 1741 certainly did not cloud her judgment about their treatment of their peasants. With regard to peasant revolts, she opined that it was only the cruelty of their lords which has driven these wretched people to such extremes. Her decision to raise the peasant question at this particular time also grew out of other strategic considerations. In 1764, her government had faced bankruptcy after the Seven Years' War and had sought a voluntary fiscal contribution from the Hungarian Diet. She and her advisers also sought some tax relief for those people who actually paid Hungary's taxes, all non-nobles, and who made up the military's rank and file as well. Suspicious of Vienna's increasingly absolutist tendencies, however, The Diet refused the financial contribution to the government and instead presented its female king with 228 of its own complaints. Largely in response to this affront, Maria Theresa had decided to place...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.